Audible Inc. presents Zombie Banks, How Broken Banks and Debtor Nations Are Crippling the Global Economy. Written by Yalman, Onaran and Sheila Bair. Narrated by Pete Larkin.
To Dad, who said he bargained with the Grim Reaper to delay the day until this book's publication. And to Mom, whose habit of playing the devil's advocate in debates taught me to consider opposing views more easily. Foreword. Many books have been written about the financial crisis. They are, perhaps, getting better with age. Perspective improves as time passes. Economic truisms that were obfuscated in the informational fog that surrounded the financial crisis are coming back into focus as the fog clears. In the years leading up to the crisis, we somehow lost our way. We confused free markets with free-for-all markets. We transitioned from a society that valued hard work and entrepreneurship to one that worshipped housing speculation and financial arbitrage. In the fall of 2008, we got our comeuppance as an economy based on over-leveraged consumers, inflated real estate prices, and artificial derivatives products finally collapsed. The Great Recession was not the product of an inevitable business cycle. It was caused by the excessive risk-taking of a number of large financial institutions. Investors and creditors supported them, notwithstanding their high-flying ways, because of the perception that the government would not let them fail. The smart money played the system, and the smart money was right. Instead of using the crisis as an opportunity to clean out the system, we bailed out most of the inefficient institutions and left the bad assets to rot on their balance sheets. Within a year, those who had been bailed out were paying themselves bonuses, while many of the bailers were losing their houses, their jobs, or both. To be sure, some of the stabilization measures undertaken in the United States were dictated by limitations on the legal tools that were available to close down failing institutions in an orderly way. And notwithstanding the shortcomings of our efforts, we did force our banks to raise significant amounts of new capital and dramatically reduce reliance on short-term funding. As a consequence, U.S. banks are much more stable today than their European counterparts. But as Yalman Onaran points out in this highly readable book, by bailing out mismanaged institutions, we repeated the mistakes of Japan's lost decade and of our own savings and loan debacle. By propping up failing firms, we penalized the well-managed institutions and interfered with the basic functioning of the market. We cannot rely on our capitalist system to allocate resources for their most productive use unless we let the inefficient or mismanaged fail. We did not force our financial institutions to shed their bad assets and recognize the losses. And the lingering uncertainty about the true extent of those losses makes previously profligate management more risk-averse in an economy where prudent risk-taking and lending are most needed, particularly by small businesses. Unfortunately, governments around the globe continue to nurture and support a bloated financial sector built around an unsustainable model. In the United States, we guarantee their mortgages and subsidize their leverage. So beholden is Washington to the big financial players that it can't even make hedge fund managers pay the same tax rates as the rest of us. To be sure, a healthy financial sector and recovering housing market are essential to our economic future, and not all financial institutions contributed to the crisis. But we have to accept the fact that financial services and the housing bubble they fueled became a disproportionate part of our global economy and a disproportionate influence over governments throughout the world. Instead of their traditional role of supporting the credit needs of the real economy, financial services became an end to themselves. The task at hand is to determine how, in defining our regulatory and fiscal priorities, we can downsize the financial sector over time and reallocate resources to areas that will generate lasting jobs and get us back onto a sustainable economic path. It is essential that we maintain course on the Basel III agreements to substantially increase both the quality and quantity of capital held by internationally active financial institutions as well as the agreement to impose an additional capital surcharge on the most systemically important. Stronger capital requirements for financial behemoths are the most direct way to constrain their size and imprudent risk-taking. Yet, as this book documents, those hard-won agreements are already under political attack. Ironically, the political debate over how to restart the global economy is devoid of any acknowledgement of the role a bloated financial services industry plays in impeding growth. Until government policymakers come to grips with the basic economic truths reflected in this book, our road to recovery will be a very slow and costly one. Sheila Bair, August 2011. Preface. The global financial crisis started much earlier for me than for most other people. I was a finance journalist covering Bear Stearns and Lehman Brothers for Bloomberg News. The problems at Bear Stearns surfaced in June 2007, and the bad news didn't let up for 1 minute until the Wall Street firm's demise in March 2008. Then, just as at a relay race, Bear Stearns handed off the baton to Lehman Brothers. The day Bear's history ended, attention turned to Lehman as the next to go down. Without skipping a beat, I also turned my attention to the bigger investment bank as its final chapter unfolded in the next 6 months. Even though for much of the world, the global financial crisis started in September 2008 with the collapse of Lehman Brothers, for me it had been going on for about 15 months by then, and I was already wiped out from working around the clock. However, because the two firms I was tasked with covering were both dead, I had a unique opportunity as well. When my colleagues reported on the global financial system freezing up, I could stop and look back at what had happened to two financial giants that had each been around for about a century. As I delved into what had gone wrong at both firms, the biggest discovery I made was that nobody completely knew what was going on inside either bank. Every executive I talked to knew one chunk of the business really well, and perhaps had some fleeting sense of a few other related departments, but none, including those at the very top, could connect all the dots. I felt as though I was talking to blind men trying to describe an elephant. Each was holding a different part of the animal, so one described it as snake-like, another as a sturdy pillar, somebody else as flapping ears. Nobody saw the whole beast. This realization came back to haunt me as I started looking into the attempts at regulatory overhaul in the United States and globally. I kept discovering that bankers, analysts, investors, regulators, and politicians all held some part of the elephant, but there seemed to be nobody with the full picture. That made rewriting the rules of the game very difficult, as it had made running Bear Stearns or Lehman Brothers successfully almost impossible. The financial system had become so complicated that no one had all the answers. The complexity had forced everyone, including journalists like me, to become experts in one small aspect of the system while forgetting the bigger picture. This book is an attempt to connect the dots that are scattered all over the financial landscape, to bring the full animal to life. There are common threads running through the European and U.S. financial realms, and the unresolved troubles of the banking system affect everyone. Irish readers probably won't be shocked to read the stories about their own country, but will be surprised to see the similarities with the other countries and how they all relate to one another. While there's a historical element throughout the book in explaining how we got into the situation we are in, it's mostly about what the current predicament is and what should be done so we can get out of it. The book comes out as the European Union wrestles with its troubled periphery and the United States with its crippled housing market. It will help make sense of those issues and uncover the solutions. It would be great if I could guide some of the policymakers toward the right solutions. However, even if I can only get some of the public informed well about them, then I can count on the pressure they'll exert on the politicians to do the right thing. People with no finance background can pick up this book and read it without difficulty. I tried to emulate the way I explain these same issues to my closest friends during private conversations, and most of them don't have any financial expertise. I tried to avoid technical terms and financial jargon, and explained even the most basic term if I had to use it. Yet there's something for the finance professional in this book, too. The trader reading Zombie Banks may already know the issues directly relating to his line of business, but will benefit from seeing the correlations and similarities, just as the lay reader will. The first two chapters explain the main concept of zombie banking and put it in historical context, especially how it led to Japan's lost decade of the 1990s. The next four chapters are about Europe's problems, its bankrupt states and broken banks, how they relate to each other. Chapter 3 looks at the debt problems of the European Union, EU, periphery, Greece, Portugal, Ireland, and Spain, and how that is connected to the bank's weaknesses in other countries. Chapters 4 through 6 analyze the banking systems of Germany, Ireland, and Iceland, one by one. You may be surprised to see the strongest and most powerful European country in the same list with the weakest and smallest, but you will be even more shocked to read about the similarities in their banks' problems. Although I have focused on these three countries' banks, that doesn't mean they're the only ones with zombie banks, or in Iceland's case, the only example of how to get rid of them. I would have also liked to delve into the French and Italian banking systems, spend more time on Spain's savings banks, and study Belgium's largest bank, the most highly leveraged lender on the continent. I just ran out of time. Making sure this book remained topical and current meant I couldn't spend many more months expanding my research into more troubled banks in other countries. Germany, Ireland, and Iceland provide the best examples to the phenomenon, though. The following three chapters are about the United States. Chapter 7 looks at the U.S. zombies. Chapter 8 highlights the political fights over how to prevent the next financial crisis. Chapter 9 builds a bridge between housing market woes and the banks. In the last two chapters, the perspective is global. Chapter 10 zooms in on the dangers of derivatives and too-big-to-fail financial institutions, and Chapter 11 suggests solutions to the problems identified throughout the book. Each of these chapters is sprinkled with entertaining and telling stories of bankers, politicians, bureaucrats, firms, and nations. To get to those stories and understand the national psyche of these different peoples, I traveled to Ireland, Iceland, and Germany in late 2010 and early 2011. I interviewed dozens of people in those countries, as well as many others in the rest of Europe and the United States. Almost everything in quotation marks comes from those interviews, except for a few cases in which I cite a newspaper column or research paper where the view was expressed. There are also dozens of people I talked to whose names aren't mentioned in the book. They requested anonymity for various reasons, and I respected that, as all journalists do. Many of the behind-the-scenes stories come from those unidentified sources. In the spirit of Bloomberg News guidelines on such material, if I couldn't reveal the source, I only used the stories that I heard from at least two different people. Even though I talked to some 100 people for this book and cite many of their views throughout, when there's no attribution, the views expressed are mine. When I interview people for Bloomberg News articles, I like to joke that as a reporter, I have no views. I only parrot the views of others I've talked to. There's a sliver of truth to that in the sense that the dozens and hundreds of perspectives I'm constantly exposed to as a reporter form my views. My views about zombie banks are derived from everything I've heard and read in the past 14 years as a financial journalist, covering multiple financial crises in various countries, in addition to the research I did specifically for the book. Although as a reporter I shy away from reflecting my own viewpoint in the articles I write, in this book I did not pull any punches. I hope you enjoy that too. I would like to thank a few people who helped make this book better. Konstantin Gurdjieff, Adrian Vandernap, Frederick Cannon, and my editor at Bloomberg News, Robert Friedman, were kind enough to read the whole manuscript and provide valuable feedback. Even Burton at John Wiley & Sons was instrumental in making it happen, and Meg Freeborn was a great editor to work with. I'm grateful to the dozens of editors I've worked with at Bloomberg in the past 14 years who've helped me become a better reporter and writer. Our editor-in-chief, Matthew A. Winkler, has inspired me to doggedly pursue the truth every time. There have been many books about how the crisis unfolded and what caused it. This one is to show that despite their claims to the contrary, politicians worldwide have not tackled the structural problems in the financial system underlying that crisis. When you read this book, I hope you can connect the dots between the street protesters in Greece, strikers in Spain, the $4 gas at the pump, and your unemployed neighbor in Alabama. We haven't fixed our banks, and that will prevent us from moving away from these troubles. Cast of characters. Joaquin Almunia, European Union Competition Commissioner, caught in a tug of war with German authorities over the future of the Landesbanks. Gunnar Andersson, head of Iceland's banking regulator since April 2009. Arni Páff Arnason, Iceland's economy minister since September 2010. Sheila Bair, chairman of the U.S. Federal Deposit Insurance Corporation, 2006 to 2011. She fought to restrict the use of taxpayer money for the rescue of failing banks and advocated stronger rules to prevent new zombies. John Bruton, Ireland's prime minister, 1994 to 1997, EU's ambassador to the United States, 2004 to 2009. Joan Burton, Ireland's social protection minister since March 2011. While she was in opposition prior to that, vocal critic of the previous government's lenience toward the banks as they grew and the handling of their troubles when they fell. Brian Cowan, Ireland's prime minister 2008 to 2011. His rescue of the nation's banks led to the collapse of the sovereign credit, forcing him to seek financial assistance from the EU. Alan Dukes, chairman of Anglo-Irish Bank since June 2010. He was appointed to wind down the worst zombie in Ireland and served as finance minister 1982 to 1986. Sean Fitzpatrick, founder of Anglo-Irish Bank. Anglo-Irish Bank grew 700 times in two decades before blowing up spectacularly in 2009. Timothy Geithner, U.S. Secretary of the Treasury since January 2009, President of the Federal Reserve Bank of New York, 2003 to 2008. He advocated and played a central role in the rescues of the biggest failing U.S. banks in 2008, and he resisted fundamental changes in regulations that would rein them in. Thomas M. Honig, President of Federal Reserve Bank of Kansas City, 1991 to 2011. He fought to end the too big to fail, TBTF, conundrum. He was sole dissenter in the Monetary Policy Committee of the Fed against keeping interest rates at zero for so long. Stefan Kompeter, Germany's deputy finance minister since 2009. He was caught between the country's regional politicians and the EU authorities as they haggled over the future of the Landesbanks. Ted Kaufman, U.S. Senator from Delaware, 2009 to 2010. Head of Congressional Oversight Panel, 2010 to 2011. He introduced legislation to limit the size of banks so they wouldn't get too big to fail, and he was a vocal critic of the bank's handling of the housing crisis. Enda Kenny, Ireland's prime minister since March 2011. He wanted the bank's bondholders to share in the losses, but was rebuffed by the EU leadership on that request. Brian Lenihan, Ireland's finance minister, May 2008 to March 2011, he decided to issue blanket guarantee for the liabilities of the nation's banks, which ended up costing more than 100 billion euros for the public. He died of cancer in June 2011. Carl Levin, U.S. Senator from Michigan. He has been fighting for strong bank regulations. Angela Merkel, Germany's chancellor, prime minister, since 2005, she has been resisting the resolution of her country's zombie banks, thereby endangering the future of the EU. Jeff Merkley, U.S. Senator from Oregon. He has been a defender of tough bank regulations. David Oddsson, Iceland's prime minister, 1991 to 2004, central bank chief, 2005 to 2009. As prime minister, he allowed the nation's banks exponential growth and oversaw their privatization. As central bank head, he refused to build the currency reserves to save them in case of failure. Henry Paulson, U.S. Secretary of the Treasury, 2006 to 2008. He played a key role in the rescue of the biggest U.S. banks during the financial crisis. Robert Rubin, U.S. Secretary of the Treasury, 1995 to 1999. Citigroup Executive, 1999 to 2009. As Treasury Chief, he was instrumental in the repeal of the 1933 law that separated investment and commercial banking. He joined the bank that benefited most from the dismantling of the rule as soon as he left the governmental administration. Joseph Stiglitz, winner of the Nobel Prize in Economics 2001, Advisor to U.S. President Bill Clinton, 1993 to 1997, Columbia University professor since 2001. He was a strong critic of the U.S. reaction to the 2008 crisis and the soft gloves used to handle the failing banks. Paul A. Volcker, chairman of the U.S. Federal Reserve, 1979 to 1987, advisor to President Barack Obama, 2009 to 2011. In a semi-formal White House role, he struggled to convince the president and his economic lieutenants to push for tougher banking regulations. He was father of the Volcker Rule, a section of the U.S. financial reform package that restricts risky trading activities of the banks. José Luis Rodríguez Zapatero, Spain's prime minister since 2004. He has been struggling to pull his country out of recession while restructuring its failed savings banks, but perhaps a bit too slowly. He said he won't seek re-election in November 2011. Chapter 1. Zombies in Our Midst. I will break in the doors of hell and smash the bolts. There will be confusion of people, those above with those from the lower depths. I shall bring up the dead to eat food like the living, and the hosts of dead will outnumber the living. The Epic of Gilgamesh, 2700 to 2300 BC. The reason most people today are so scared of zombies could be a fluke of translation. The idea of the flesh-eating zombie depicted in modern-day books and movies originates from a 5,000-year-old epic in which the goddess of love asks the father of gods to create a drought to punish the man who rejected her love. She then threatens to stir up the dead if her wish isn't granted. Written in Sumerian, Babylonian, and other ancient languages, naturally there are multiple versions of the epic poem and different translations of those variations. While many translations depict zombies eating food with or like the living, some drop the preposition altogether and have the creatures of the underworld eating humans directly. Zombie banks may not eat people or other banks, but their harm to society, the financial system, and the economy is just as scary. The origins of the term zombie bank are much more recent than the Epic of Gilgamesh. The expression was first used by Boston College professor Edward J. Cain in an academic paper published in 1987. It referred to the savings and loans institutions in the United States that were insolvent, but allowed to stay among the living by their regulators turning a blind eye to their losses. The term gained prominence in the next decade when it was more widely used to denote Japanese banks, whose refusal to face their losses and clean up their balance sheets was blamed for the industrialized nation's so-called lost decade. During the financial crisis in 2008, bloggers, columnists, analysts, and even politicians began using it when talking about the weakest banks in the United States and Europe. In its simplest form, zombie bank refers to an insolvent financial institution whose equity capital has been wiped out so that the value of its obligations is greater than its assets. The level of capital is crucial for banks, more so than for non-financial companies, because in the event of bankruptcy, a bank's assets lose value faster and to a bigger extent. Thus, when a bank's equity declines significantly due to losses, its creditors panic and head for the doors. Deposits are insured in most Western economies, so depositors don't run away as easily. Capital is the size of the buffer that protects creditors of a bank from losses. Even though technically wiped out capital means bankruptcy, and rules in many countries require the authorities to seize a lender in such a condition and wind it down, history is full of examples when that was not done. The dead bank is, instead, kept among the living through capital infusions from the government, loans from the central bank, and what is generally referred to as regulatory forbearance, that is, giving the lender leeway on postponing the recognition of losses. The intention is that economic conditions will improve and losses will be reversed. The bank will be able to make profits over time to cover the remaining losses and return to health. Yet there are many shades of gray when it comes to identifying insolvent banks. Publicly available balance sheets don't always tell the whole truth. Cain, who was born during the Great Depression, says the outside estimates about a bank's capital position can't be exact. So when those estimates teeter near the point of insolvency, the bank will have a hard time borrowing new money. You shouldn't think of zombiness as just a 1-0 event, that a bank is or isn't, and that you can prove it, Kane says. When the estimates of the bank's capital fall near the negative area, then people are not going to lend money to them at reasonable rates. Only the taxpayer will do that. According to R. Christopher Whalen, investment banker and author, a bank doesn't have to be insolvent at all points in time to be called a zombie. Since early 2009, Whalen has been using the term to refer to the weakest U.S. banks. When a firm fails and is brought back from the dead by the government and kept alive by ongoing support, then that's a zombie, Whalen says. The institution's true return to health can only be tested when all government backing is off and it can stand on its own, he adds. These zombies don't eat people, they eat money, Whalen wrote in March 2009, so we don't have to worry about which version of the Epic of Gilgamesh to believe. It's the taxpayer money that zombie banks eat, and that's where their harm to society is. Because today's banks are like black boxes, keeping many of their inner workings to themselves, it's impossible to know whether they're zombies for sure. Thomas M. Honig, who was a bank examiner at the Federal Reserve Bank of Kansas City before becoming its president, says he could only tell whether some of today's weakest banks are zombies if he could go in and examine them in the same detailed way. But it's not even possible to examine the largest institutions, at least not in the detail Honig would like. If the same resources deployed to study the books of a small community bank were used for Citigroup, the third largest U.S. bank, 70,000 examiners would be needed, according to a Kansas City Fed analysis. About 20 inspectors try to do that job now on behalf of the Federal Reserve Bank of New York, and another 70 from the Office of the Comptroller of the Currency, the two regulators responsible for monitoring Citigroup. The Art of Keeping Zombies Alive. When banks face death due to surging losses in a downturn or financial crisis, authorities resort to multiple tools to keep them alive. Capital injections and liquidity provision are the most common. Governments invest in troubled banks when private capital shies away from doing so due to fears of insolvency. Since the 2008 crisis started, governments from the state of Bavaria to Switzerland to the Netherlands have put some $600 billion of capital into their banks. Although some of that has been paid back or replaced with private funds, as was the case with the largest U.S. banks, most of it still remains, and some nations, like Ireland, were pumping new cash into their institutions as this book was being penned. Central bank lending to weak firms is also crucial. At the height of the crisis, the total lending programs of the U.S. Federal Reserve totaled $8.2 trillion, with another $8.9 trillion of funding provided by the Treasury and the Federal Deposit Insurance Corporation, FDIC. While a majority of those have been wound down, $7.8 trillion were still outstanding as of October 2010, according to a tally by Nomi Prinz, author of It Takes a Pillage, An Untold Story of Power, Deceit, and Untold Trillions. Prinz adds to that another $6.8 trillion of Freddie Mac and Fannie Mae liabilities taken on by the government, arguing that the two mortgage finance giants' rescue was, in effect, an indirect subsidy to the banks. Figure 1.1. Figure 1.1 may be accessed at the same place where you purchased this audiobook. If Freddie and Fannie had collapsed, U.S. banks would have been stuck with massive losses on their $2 trillion holdings of the two mortgage lenders' bonds. At the end of July 2011, the European Central Bank, ECB, was still providing about $500 billion of short-term funding to the continent's banks. Although the central banks argue such loans are backed by collateral from the banks, data released by the Fed in March 2011 showed that it allowed the use of $118 billion of junk bonds, those with non-investment-grade ratings, meaning higher risk of defaulting, as collateral by the largest banks borrowing from it. The same day that the Fed's crisis lending facts were released, the ECB announced that it would suspend its requirement of accepting only investment-grade bonds as collateral to lend against Irish debt. It had exempted Greek sovereign bonds from its minimum rating requirement a year earlier, just as rating agencies downgraded the country's debt to below investment grade. That was akin to the ECB saying to Irish banks or others holding Irish government debt, "Don't worry if Ireland's sovereign risk is downgraded to junk. We'll still accept its bonds, just like we accept Greece's junk." The ECB exempted Portugal's government bonds from the rule in July 2011, when they were downgraded to junk ahead of Ireland's debt. Ireland followed suit just a few weeks later. The money that central banks use to stabilize markets and prevent panic also arrests the decline in asset values, even if that means a property bubble that was at the heart of the crisis to begin with cannot pop all the way. The Fed's purchase of $1.3 trillion of mortgage bonds from January 2009 to March 2010 lowered interest rates on home loans in the United States and stopped the slide of housing prices, even if just temporarily. That slows the zombies bleeding from losses and lets them write some assets up in value and look solvent. Another form of assistance to zombie banks is government backing for their debt, old and new. United States banks sold $280 billion of bonds backed by the government before the program was abolished at the end of 2009. European Union banks have used $1.3 trillion of state guarantees. While the explicit guarantees for the bank's debt are being phased out in both continents, implicit guarantees remain. Because the U.S. and European governments have made it clear that they won't let their largest institutions fail, even the weakest lenders are able to borrow private money. The German government's implicit backing for its lenders raises the ratings of its banks by as many as 8 levels, credit rating agency Moody's Investor Service says. That means without the so-called support uplift, many would be rated below investment grade. In the United States, that uplift is as high as 5 notches for Bank of America. Without the government banking, the bank's rating by Moody's would drop to just 2 levels above junk. The litmus test to be considered truly alive is whether they're able to function without government support of any kind, says Whalen. Perhaps the biggest subsidy given to all banks in Europe and the United States, though it particularly helps the zombies stay alive, is the near 0% interest rate policy maintained by the central banks on both sides of the Atlantic since the start of the crisis. The banks can borrow from their central bank at close to zero and then lend to their own governments at 4 to 10%. That's a backdoor subsidy, and the banks need that subsidy to repair their balance sheets, says David Kotok, chief investment officer at Cumberland Advisors, a longtime critic of the policies. If the banks receive this cash injection long enough, they'll be able to make enough profits to cover their losses from the crisis, some of which are still not recognized. The delayed recognition of the losses is central to the life zombie banks live. Accounting rules are changed or suspended to let them push out some of their losses to future years. Capital regulations are also put on hold to allow for time to rebuild capital. Regulators reassure the public and investor that the banks are safe and sound, even when they don't necessarily believe that. The two main agencies responsible for accounting rules in the world, the Financial Accounting Standards Board of the United States and the International Accounting Standards Board, rushed in late 2008 to early 2009 to tweak regulations that would force banks to recognize declining loan values immediately as defaults surged. Bank regulators around the world, compelled to tighten capital rules under public pressure, put off the implementation of harsher standards for 5 to 13 years, knowing that the zombie banks would need all of that time to fix their problems. Stress tests were conducted by U.S. and EU authorities to show that the largest banks were healthy enough to withstand another crisis. Even though both used optimistic assumptions about the future risks to housing markets and economic shocks, the U.S.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.